Luke chapter 8, beginning in verse 40. Luke 8 and 40. I still hear paper. That's kind of odd. Luke 8 and 40. Now, when Jesus returned, the crowd welcomed him, for they were all waiting for him. And there came a man named Jairus, who was a ruler of the synagogue. And falling at Jesus' feet, he implored him to come to his house. For he had an only daughter, about 12 years of age, and she was dying. As Jesus went, the people pressed around him, and there was a woman who had had a discharge of blood for 12 years. And though she had spent all her living on physicians, she could not be healed by anyone. She came up behind him and touched the fringe of his garment, and immediately her discharge of blood ceased. And Jesus said, "Who was it that touched me?" When all denied it, Peter said, "Master, the crowd surround you and are pressing in on you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me, for I perceive that power has gone out of me." And when the woman saw she was not hidden, she came trembling and falling down before him, declared in the presence of all the people why she had touched him, and how she had been immediately healed. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace." Verse 49, while he was still speaking, someone from the ruler's house came and said, "Your daughter is dead. Do not trouble the teacher anymore." But Jesus, on hearing this, answered him, "Do not fear, only believe, and she will be well." And when he came to the house, he allowed no one to enter with him except Peter, John, and James, and the father and mother of the child. And all were weeping and mourning for her. But he said, "Do not weep, for she is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. But taking her by the hand, he called her, saying, "Child, arise." And her spirit returned, and she got up at once. And he directed that something should be given her to eat. And her parents were amazed, but he charged them to tell no one what had happened. For how many years was the woman sick? 12. And how old was the synagogue ruler's daughter? 12. So there is a significance in this where Jesus is talking about that the woman suffered for 12 years in a physical affliction, and she was harshly judged under the law. For 12 years, the ruler, Jairus, he had his only daughter. I only have one daughter, and so I can understand. That he has lavished the fruit of his prominence upon his only daughter. And likewise, the woman exhausted all of the fruit of her livelihood to address her affliction under the law and medically. A 12-year-old girl, the only daughter, and for 12 years she has been the recipient of lavish fruit of her father. And a woman for 12 years who had been plagued with bleeding has poured out all of the fruit that she had to try to preserve and heal herself. And on this moment in time, both were walking out what life had dealt them. See, the ruler in the synagogue, he was not exempt from the evils of the world attacking his family. So just because we're church people does not mean that we have this free pass and that the enemy is going to leave us alone. As long as we're doing the will and work of God, the enemy is going to do whatever he will to distract us from that purpose. And as long as we're living out in this life, this flesh that we dwell in, it is corruptible. It is dying. No matter how healthy we are and how much we work to make this body last longer, the reality is it is still dying. And so both of them are walking out what life had presented itself to them, both in the context of where they were in their lives. Until this day, when they both became desperate for the exact same thing, Jesus. Both of these are Jews. Both of these living under the law. I would like to think that the ruler of the synagogue was adhering to all of the feast, adhering to all of the sacrifices, adhering to all of the giving responsibilities. I mean, he's a Pharisee in the synagogue, so I mean, he should be adhering to at least the letter of the law. And here's a woman, a Jew, who I'm sure had been trying to walk out the exact same letter of the law in her life, trying to find that healing virtue of God. And in this moment of great desperation, they both reach out to a man that the current religious establishment has an issue with. Did you think about that? Jesus was a rebel in the eyes of the religious establishment. And yet here's a synagogue ruler and a woman who has been a devout Jew all her life. They're both coming to this man by the name of Jesus. And we understand that it is a man that they are coming to. Everyone understands that, right? It is a man that they've heard about and a man that they're coming to. We're going to take a brief pause and just look at a side note on the number 12. The number 12 is considered a perfect number. The number 12 symbolizes God's absolute power and his sovereign authority. The number 12 is completeness as it pertains to governance and leadership. We see this that Jacob had 12 sons. And those 12 sons became the heads of the 12 tribes, at least not physically, but their names and their lineage became the 12 tribes of Israel. When Jesus called his disciples, he called 12 ordinary men to be his disciples. And upon the baptism of the Holy Spirit, they became apostles of the church. Except for the one named Judas Iscariot who betrayed Jesus, yet he was replaced by Matthias. Here was an interesting point. Girls are considered mature at the age of 12. And Jairus' daughter was how old? 12. It's called the Bat Mitzvah. And here's just a little tidbit, which parents might be able to understand. Boys are not considered mature until they're 13. Hey, when they have their bar mitzvah. So I thought that was a little irony that the girl was 12 years old, and at the age of 12, they're considered mature. And then there's a modern, I mean, the bat mitzvah, bar mitzvah has really just been a huge modern expression, very similar to the quinceañeras. Y'all can relate to that, right? It's just a great celebration. You spend a lot of money and you wonder why. The last thing that I thought was interesting, and there's many others, and you can go research it yourself. 187 times the number 12 is in the scriptures. 22 times it is in the book of Revelation. Of course, we know that there were 12 patriarchs, there are 12 minor prophets, and you can just keep going on and on. But the last thing I wanted to make note of, if you had been here during our Scarlet Letters teaching, the first recorded words of Jesus was when he was at the age of 12. So moving on, understanding that it means completeness, that there is this divergence, or there's this crossing, this intersection with these two lives upon Jesus in his life. Desperation is what would bring these two characters to this crossroad with Jesus. This is most likely not their very first encounter with each other. Consider this. Having been the ruler of the synagogue, a Pharisee, Jairus, he must have been fully aware of the woman's affliction. Because the ruler of the synagogue is the one that sets the things in order of the synagogue. So who's going to read the scriptures, make sure that you know the certain ordinances that are supposed to be in the synagogue are in place? Well, he's also the one that oversees the sacrifices and the offerings that are given. And so he had to have been at least aware or engaged of this woman's condition. Maybe even fully aware of her affliction. Even possible he may have counseled her. And he may have been one of the ones that was in the process of walking her through how to become whole. That was their job. That was their role in the synagogue. Over time, as she no longer was showing signs of redeeming of her body, it's very possible that Jairus had to make a very tough decision. And that tough decision would be to excommunicate this woman from the synagogue indefinitely because she was unclean. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 15. Leviticus chapter 15, beginning in verse 25. And you can read the scriptures before and after what I'm going to read, but this just particularly pertains to what this woman was actually going through. If a woman has a discharge of blood for many days, not at the time of her menstrual impurity. So this was not her normal cycle, okay? This was completely outside of that, which this is what Leviticus is addressing. Or if she has a discharge beyond the time of her impurity, all the days of the discharge, she shall continue in uncleanness. As in the days of her impurity, she shall be unclean. Verse 26, every bed on which she lies all the days of her discharge shall be to her as the bed of her impurity, and everything on which she sits shall be unclean, as in the uncleanness of her menstrual impurity. Verse 27, and whoever touches these things, shall be unclean, and shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water, and be unclean until the evening. Keep Leviticus in mind as we continue to navigate through this particular story. So everything that the woman wore, everything that she would touch, everything she sat on, and any of those elements, if any other person had touched them, all would be unclean according to the law. Here's another thing to consider. It's highly likely many in the crowd could have also been aware of this woman's situation. I mean, consider, it's been 12 years. If all of us have been going to church for 12 years, that's a pretty good length of time. Over that amount of time, we would eventually know each other a little more intimately than, hi, how are you? God is good today. Right? Well, you would think so. If we've been in church for 12 years together and we don't know each other a little more intimately, then we have a great big problem. So we understand that, so that this was 12 years, and so if this was Beeville, especially today with social media, what's the likelihood that everybody in the town, in the city, would have had knowledge of her condition? And know that she was physically and ceremonially unclean. The population of Capernaum around this time was almost 1,500 people. So consider this. All of these Jews know the law. They know what it means to be unclean. They could have potential knowledge of this woman, and she is out in public among these people. That means every person that she happened to come in contact with from the moment she left her house to the moment she touched Jesus, they're also unclean. The entire crowd is unclean just by virtue of her being in their midst. Now, we don't see this in the scriptures, but can you imagine Jairus coming to Jesus and telling him, my daughter is on the verge of death, ruler of the synagogue. And Jesus says, let's go, you know, and he starts walking. And this woman touches him, and he goes, who touched me? Everything stops at that moment. That means Jairus may have been leading the way, and he has to stop as well. Turn around to observe what's going on. And in this moment, when Jesus is supposed to be going to heal his daughter, he sees this woman whom he's had knowledge of being unclean in Capernaum, who has delayed Jesus from going to his house to heal his daughter. Can you imagine what could be going through Jairus' mind and his emotions at this time? His one and only daughter on her deathbed, and this unclean woman has the audacity to stop Jesus and touch him with her uncleanness. And even worse, he stops. Come on, dads, think about that. You don't understand. We got to go now. We don't have time for you to be dealing with this unclean woman. He's a Pharisee. He's not thinking about being politically correct. By the way, that didn't exist back then. All he's worried about is daughter, unclean, go. Let's move. So can you just imagine the emotional tension that could be going on in this particular instant? A daughter of the man and a daughter of God. 12 years. There's this connection, and now they both need something from the man Jesus. On this day, both of them actually break Levitical, social, cultural, political, emotional, physical, and spiritual barriers. There is not a single barrier or a single piece of their upbringing, of the law, of their culture, that they don't cross in this particular moment. The ruler of the synagogue. Now, Capernaum is not too far from where Jesus was in the synagogue and read the scriptures. You remember that? When he says today, he reads out of Isaiah, and he says, today, this is fulfilled in your ears. Who are you? Aren't you Joseph's son? I mean, so this is very close to where he's from. So these people all know. And even Jairus, being a synagogue ruler, I'm sure he got an email that said, or a text that said, hey, watch out for this Jesus character when he comes to your area. Be aware of him. The high priest, our leadership, believes that he has questionable motives. Jairus even stepping to go after Jesus puts his entire, just like Nicodemus in John chapter 3, it puts him at a very, very critical point. He could lose his job. He could lose all of his influence. He could lose all of his wealth because he could be put in prison and have to pay a fine. So he crosses the Levitical boundary. He crosses all social boundaries because he knows that this man who believes is a prophet, but there is questionable, that many believe that he's a blasphemer. Rome was always the ever-observant big brother. There were Roman troops and guards everywhere observing these things, doing it from a distance, letting them walk out their own geopolitical and religious activity. And so there's this political atmosphere that could completely erupt right before their eyes in the Roman political system. Jairus can't heal his own daughter, so he's bound by her physical demise. The woman has spent everything and she can't heal herself, and there's nothing that she's invested in that could heal her, and so she is bound by her own physical demise. And on this day, their desperation individually set them on a relentless pursuit of this man named Jesus. Against all odds and everything they have known their entire lives. And what does Jesus do? Jesus doesn't look at Jairus and go, like he had dealt with all the other religious people. Did you notice he did not respond to Jairus like he did everyone else? No, he doesn't even blink, doesn't even flinch. He just starts to go with the man. So against all odds, everything they've known their entire lives, and Jesus transcends all of these barriers, particularly the priestly and the Levitical demands, to do one thing, and that's demonstrate God's power. Jesus was not bound by any of man's traditions. Jesus was not bound even by the law. As a matter of fact, as we've learned, Jesus came to fulfill the law, which means that what Jesus was doing was actually part of the fulfilling of the law. See, the law couldn't heal either one of them. The law couldn't raise Jairus' daughter from the dead. The law could not heal this woman of the issue of blood. It needed the ultimate sacrifice. It needed the anointing of the Messiah, the Christ, to come in and grab the law and say, "You can't do it, but I will." And so he transcended all priestly and Levitical demands to demonstrate God's power. And to make matters worse, he allowed this unclean woman to touch him. Jesus is completely unclean, and according to what we read in Leviticus, immediately he needs to go back to his house, strip everything down, purify himself, and he cannot leave his home until after dark. He is unclean until after dark. He allowed this one. So where were the religious on this day saying, "Had you know the manner of woman touched you?" Where were they at? Well, they weren't there because they'd be unclean too. So immediately when she touches him, he's unclean. And he doesn't go through the purification process. As a matter of fact, he talks to her. He tells her that her faith has made her whole. Thereby, in that entire conversation, telling the entire crowd, she is no longer unclean. He has declared that all of the stuff that she'd done in her life and everything that was going on that made her unclean, she is no longer unclean. She is absolutely whole and purified this moment. And subsequently, which we would understand, if she's purified and made clean, then what? Everyone else is too. But no, he doesn't. He doesn't stop to go purify himself. The crowd doesn't disband so that they can go become clean. No, after he sets her in order, he turns around and the servant comes and says, "Don't bother the master anymore. Your daughter's dead." And he says, "Just believe. Just believe. Believe." See, Jairus came initially being driven because of the love of his daughter and being desperate in his desperation and his relentlessness, just circumventing all odds. He demonstrated something that Jesus was always motivated by, and that was faith. His faith is what ultimately got him there. And Jesus was basically telling him, continue to believe. Don't lose heart. Don't stop believing. Don't stop. You came to me for something. We're going to see this through no matter what it looks like. Jesus goes back, follows him, goes to the house, and there's mourners. Back in this day, they would hire groups of people to mourn. The more that they wanted the people to believe that the person who died was of some great value and significance, the more mourners that they would hire to scream and holler and wail and travail. And Jesus comes in and he sees all this shenanigans going on and he basically says, "Psh, what's up with y'all? She's sleeping." And that's why they're laughing. We've seen dead. Dead is dead. There's no life in this besides we want to get our check. We want to get paid for doing our duties, right? For mourning and doing what has been asked. Jesus goes in there in the same room with a dead person. Well, as blood was unclean, guess what? A dead person was equally unclean. So all of the purification that Jesus said, your faith has made you whole, and everything else was purified. Now Jesus goes and puts himself right back in an unclean situation, thereby transcending, again, everything that he transcended there. See, the two moments are actually the same moment in time. Or I shouldn't say the same moment in time. The same moment in the spirit. They were different moments because we're bound by time. But in the spirit, the little girl was already healed, like the woman was already healed. In Jesus' spirit, he already knew that they were healed. That's why he can speak like he spoke. That's why he can continue to walk like this. He was not worried or concerned with what anyone thought. He could have been immediately arrested right then and taken to prison. But he didn't. He goes and he tells the little girl to arise, to wake up. And immediately she does. And she comes alive. Let's go to James chapter 1. Keep James chapter 1 and chapter 2 handy. I'm going to just read a few scriptures as we go along. James 1 and 2. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Verse 12. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those who love him. Verse 16, do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Verse 22, but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in the mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. Go to chapter 2, verse 14. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. And then move to verse 26. For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead. So there are several things that come out of this that we are to be steadfast when trials come our way. Jairus went to Jesus, and instead of losing his mind when the woman touched him, he remained steadfast until he heard the word of the Lord. You see, when he went to Jesus and said, "My daughter is on the verge of death," Jesus went to go. The word, which is Jesus, began to go so that life can be spoken into his daughter. When a concern outside of Jairus came in, he stood and stood fast until he heard the word of the Lord. Only believe. The woman, she's Mark says that she in Mark chapter 9, it says that she said to herself, "If I can but touch the hem of his garment," not even his physical body, but "if I can at least touch something that is touching him, I will be made whole." And in that instant, she was made whole. And when he said, "Who touched me?" she could have ran. She could have lied. She could have denied it. But she stood fast. And her courage, the very thing that made her relentless and desperate to begin with, stood up and said, "It was me. And this is what happened to me." And she's standing there waiting to be stoned. That's what should have happened to her. She should have been stoned right on the spot. And she's standing there, ready for her punishment, steadfast until she hears a word from the Lord. "Thy faith has made you whole." Both of them have faith. Both of them stepping out and doing something that defies all the odds. It's not enough to just have faith and sit in our prayer closet and pray and pray and pray and pray and fast and fast and fast and fast and read the word and read the word and read the word. There has to be something that comes along with that. I was telling Barbara this morning, she was telling me about her son, and he really needs to be with family. His care needs to be not alone, not by himself. And so I encouraged her this morning that while he was going through what he was going through, the word was spoken to him by his mama. The word of God was deposited in the soil of her son's life. And she didn't just sit at home and pray and fast. No, she went to the hospital. She went so that her son can hear the word of the Lord, the anointing and the authority and the power in a mama. And she spoke that word to him. She spoke it over him. And so I told her, "Don't worry. I mean, we don't know the outcome, but the seed has been deposited. The seed has been planted. Now she can pray. Now she can fast. Now she can encourage." And that's the watering. That's the nurturing. Had she not gone, no seed would have been planted in that boy's life. Well, he's a grown man. It's her boy. But he's a grown man. Faith without work is dead. See, none of this makes sense to us in the natural. It absolutely doesn't make sense to the Jews. Listen, Jesus still does not make sense to the Jews. But even more, Jesus doesn't make sense to the world. Jesus does not make sense to the world. I saw a quote by he's kind of an atheist, worldly kind of person. And he talks about that, and he says that faith in God is clinging to something that you can't see. He says, but faith is clinging to nothing. That sounds pretty profound, doesn't it? It's a lie. It is a lie. Faith is not clinging to something that we can't see. Faith is clinging to the hope of what we know. That's the absolute difference, is we have faith on what we know, not on what we can't see. Yes. Either the word is the truth or it's a lie. Y'all are not getting very excited. So that must mean it's a lie, right? Wow. I'm the only one excited, I guess. I'm the only one sweating up here. If y'all are sweating, you're not working hard enough. Look, I'm doing all the work for everybody. That's okay. That's okay. I'll do all the work for everyone. That means I get all the seed of the word, right? That means I get all the blessing of the word, right? That means I reap all the rewards of the word, right? That's okay. I'll do all the work. Y'all just chill. Okay, y'all just chill. Y'all just chill, all right? Becky and I, you ready? Soak it up. Go get the baskets, babe. We're gonna catch all this word that they're not getting, okay? We're gonna take it home with us. Look, Jesus broke everything that the law, that the people thought the law could provide, but the law was never established to provide. He broke all of the traditions of men to honor the relentless desperation of faith demonstrated by Jairus and this woman. They reached out to the man by faith, and they received the Redeemer. See, that's what it's all about. We reach out by faith in the name, and what we receive, we never even asked for. See, we reached out to Jesus and His grace because He loved us. And what did we receive? We received salvation. We receive healing. We receive deliverance. We have liberty. Even greater, we receive all authority. We receive anointing. We receive power. Yes. All because we have pursued Jesus. We pursued Him and we received God and the fullness of God. Hebrews 11 and Hebrews 12. You can pull them both up. Hebrews 11 and Hebrews 12. Beginning in verse 1 in both. Hebrews 11 and 1. Now. Say now.
Now.
Now. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the people of old received their commendation. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the Word of God. Who's the Word? Jesus. Jesus is the Word. That we understand that the universe was created by the Christ of God, the Word of God. So that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. Hebrews 12 and 1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and every sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Looking to whom? Jesus, who is the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despised the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Our relentless desperation has to be embodied in the Word. If we're not speaking the Word, see, we already have Jesus. If you don't, you better get Him. If you don't, you better find Him. And you know where you can find Him? He's here.
Yes.
Look at your neighbor. If you need Jesus, go to your neighbor and tell him, I need Jesus. That's how we find Jesus. You don't have to come to me. Matter of fact, it's better if you don't come to me. We have the Word in us, and the word is powerful. Something I heard, and it just really connected with what I already believe and what I've been trying to put out. That, do you know that praying and fasting and reading the word does not change God? Going to go a little farther. Praying and fasting and reading the word does not move God. Praying and fasting without speaking the word. In Matthew, we learn that the sower sows the word. The sower sows what? The word. The word is the seed of God. If we've not spoke the word over something, praying and fasting and reading the scripture, we're not watering anything. That's why I encourage Barbara. She spoke the word. She's got seed in that ground. And now all of us, we agree with her, we yoke up with her, we pray, we fast, we read the scriptures, we speak life and encouragement into her. She takes that life and encouragement, speaks it into her son. Now the seed can do something. Now God is going to move because something's planted. Now it has opportunity to bear fruit. Without the seed of the word, there is no fruit. Why do you say this? It's because I'm sick and tired of people being sick. Look, I love y'all, but I'm going to say something. You're not going to like it. When sickness comes into the family, the very first thing we should do is speak the word over the sickness, not run to the ER. I love y'all. Y'all understand? I'm tired of us being sick. There's a reason, because we are on the cusp of doing something great in the kingdom in Beeville. And we have to change how we've been doing things for so long. As a parent, I understand. Okay? So don't think that I'm just a rotten, horrible parent. Because I have her to balance me out. But never, never, guys, unless they got a sucking chest wound or a bone is sticking out. We didn't take our kids to the emergency room. We don't go to the emergency room. I texted with someone this morning, and it just came over me. Let's stop talking about hating that we're sick and start speaking to the sickness. Yes. Telling it to leave, telling it to flee. It has no power, no authority over this body. I don't know about you, but I don't have $200 or $300 to be popping out to the ER every time I go. And if we're popping out that money to the ER, that means it's not an instrument. If you were here Thursday, it's not an instrument of God's grace out there. Satan is robbing us, stealing, killing, and destroying all that God has blessed us with. And until you get tired of it and become relentlessly desperate, it's not going to change. Nothing's going to change. I sure hope you still love me. Look, I will be here sweating, coughing, hacking. And you're like, well, you're going to make us all sick. That's the problem. You think I'm going to make you sick. I don't think I'm sick. That's right. I have an affliction that is trying to keep me from doing what God has called me to do. I spoke the word over it. I get up and I wash my face. I take a shower so I get all that filthy, sicky smell off me. And I go do what God has called me to do. Amen. Until I can't do it anymore. Yes, there was a time I had to rest, but I wasn't down for 3 days or a week. I was down one day, and I hated it. Soon as I could, I was up and back at it again. Look, this is not, I'm not telling you anything that I'm not living. If the enemy can keep the church down and sick and paying out the nose for hospital and doctor bills, then we will never do what God has called us to do. We can't move into that next level because we are being controlled. The scripture says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, lack of wisdom, lack of application in the word. See, our desperation for Christ, if it's not motivating us to relentless faith action, then we're not desperate enough to experience the kingdom in our life and generation. Can't say, oh God, use me. I need to go to the ER. I'm sorry. I love y'all. I already warned you. If you're in the hospital, I'm not coming to see you. If I come see you, you will die. That's not funny. Because if we're only in the hospital because we didn't exercise the seed of the word, if we didn't exercise all that God has planted in us, I don't want you in the hospital. The longer you're there, the longer you're spending money, the kingdom is being hindered and not being advanced in your life. That's what I care about. If I go to the hospital to visit you, and I'm pouring out into you what I've already been pouring out week over week over week over week, then apparently we weren't listening. You know, if I go to the hospital, I'm not going to tell you anything different than I haven't already told you. Man, y'all are looking at me ugly. Don't turn around, babe. It's bad. I'm getting mean mugged from all four corners. I wrote my resignation, so if y'all want it, afterwards I'll give it to you. It is words, but I'm telling you the word. Jesus does not want us to be sick. We cannot sing this song. And I appreciate Zay. And actually, she did it a lot better than I would have. I would have come up here and y'all would have had it. You know, I'd have pulled out both swords and just started slinging. Because we can't sing what we don't believe. Either he's broke every chain or he didn't. Either the word is true or it's a lie. And you can blame our previous worship leader. Man, he instilled that in me. He says, why do we sing what we don't believe? They're just words. Not the word. If our desperation for Christ isn't moving or motivating us to relentless faith action, then we're not desperate enough to experience the kingdom that God has set up for us in our life and our generation. Three questions I leave you with, and I'm done. How relentless and desperate are we towards Christ to fulfill our mission? Can't say we want him to use us and we're not doing anything to plant seed to be used. How relentless and desperate are we to be Christ? The I am lives in you. He's not off in the cosmos. He lives in you. The I am dwells in you so you can be. Same verb, just different form. How relentless and desperate are we to be Christ in our community? And finally, how relentless and desperate are we in our disciple making? The reason we don't make disciples is because we don't understand what it means to be discipled. The learner, when he is being discipled or she is being discipled, the fruit of that discipleship is they begin to take on the persona, not always of the teacher, but of what the teacher's teaching, and even more importantly, of what the teacher's living. So the indictment this morning is not on you. It's on me. Because if you're not living what I've been teaching, then either I'm teaching a false gospel or I'm not living it in front of you. Let's pray. Father, let your spirit shine through us this morning, that we know and we have a confidence in the word that has been deposited in our lives. This is not condemnation on anyone. The word is truth, and the truth sets us free. The word is life. It's healing to every facet of our being. The word is power so that we can walk out this life as God intended us to walk it out. How can we be healing to those who are sick when we are sick ourselves? So, Father, I thank you this morning that your word has been deposited in each and every one of your people. The soil of their soul and their heart, Father God, is good soil. And once we have knowledge of the word, knowledge of the seed that has been deposited in us, it is up to us to nurture, to grow, and to harvest it. So Lord, I thank you for the seed and of your word that has been deposited in each one. And I speak life to that seed, Father. I speak wholeness to that seed. I speak encouragement, Father God, healing to their physical bodies, Father, renewing and restoring to their minds, Father God. Father, an understanding like never before of who they are in your Son, that all authority, all power, all anointing, and the creative word of a sovereign God is on their lips. Father, raise up your people as you have called them to be raised up like never before. Let this word, Father God, turn and churn and grow and to bear fruit in their lives that they out there will see and know that they are your disciples. Lord, I thank you and I praise you for your people. I thank you and I praise you, Father, for their faithfulness. I thank you, Lord, for the seeds that they have sown financially into the ministry, Father God, their faithfulness of sowing their financial seeds into this church, Father God, for the work of the ministry. Their faithfulness, Lord, in giving above and beyond. Their faithfulness, Father God, in touching the lives of the people that are around them. I thank you for the faithfulness, Lord. I pray that it continues to return back a harvest in their lives. In Jesus' name, amen.